Good evening. I'm Stesha Brandon, the Literature and Humanities Program Manager at the Seattle Public Library. As we begin tonight, I would like to acknowledge that we are on Indigenous land. These are the traditional unceded territories of the Coast Salish people, specifically the Duwamish people. We honor their elders past and present and thank them for their stewardship of this land. Welcome to the third in our five-part series, Growing Up, a literary series about growing pains, curated by D.A. Navoti and presented in partnership with Open Books, a poem emporium. We're grateful to our author series sponsors, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation and the Seattle Times for generous support of library programs. Thank you as well to the Seattle Public Library Foundation. Private gifts to the foundation from thousands of donors help the library provide free programs and services that touch the lives of everyone in our community. I have a couple quick announcements before we get started. As I mentioned, this is the third in a five-part series, and so you'll want to save the date for the next program, Thursday, June 17th. DA will share a little bit more about the content of that program in a little bit. And I also wanted to give a shout out to our partners over at Open Books. They are one of what I think are just two poetry-only bookstores in the United States, and we are so lucky to have them in Seattle. And so we would love for you to support them as you're able. So we're popping a link to the store in the chat. Several of the speakers' books today are available through Open Books, and so that's great. We'll also be posting links as the program continues. And then after tonight's program, we're interested in hearing from you. We'll post a link to a survey in the chat, and we would appreciate it if you took a minute after the event to fill that out. We'd love to hear what you think. Now I'm delighted to welcome D.A. Navoti, the curator for this new series, who will introduce tonight's event. D.A. Navoti is a member of the Gila River Indian community and a nonfiction and poetic prose writer. His work has appeared in Homology Lit, Spartan, Indian Country Today, Cloud Throat, and elsewhere. He produces the literary series We the Indigenous and co-created Fight for Our Lives, a reading series supporting communities targeted by divisive politics. He's a 2020 Radical Imagination Grant recipient from the NDN Collective and was a 2020 City Artist from the City of Seattle Office of Arts and Culture. Please help me welcome D.A. Navoti.
Awesome. Hello. Thank you so much for that welcome and welcome everyone. Thank you so much for attending this literary series, Growing Up, a literary series about growing pains. Recently for the series, we collaborated with Seattle Arts and Lectures Youth Poet Laureate Program and You Speak Seattle. And we were just absolutely delighted to hear from young artists from our communities who reminded me definitely about the hardships of being a teenager in the 21st century, which is no small feat. So similarly, and tonight, our theme is focused on parenthood. And what is there to say about parenthood? Well, there are many things. For instance, writer Anna Quintlin says, children should have enough freedom to be themselves once they've learned the rules. Sir Peter Ustinov says, parents are the bones on which children cut their teeth. Well, a little dark there, but despite that, an actress, Helen Hayes, argues, childhood is a short season. So parent, on the other hand, from what I understand, is the longest of all seasons, I've been told. So with us tonight are four brilliant, absolutely brilliant writers who will walk us through their parenthood from their point of view. That might mean the writers might read to us as mothers. For others, it might mean that they read to and for mothers, stepmothers, mother figures, chosen mothers, and more. But with us tonight is writer and wits teaching artist Arlene Naganawa, essayist and poet Margot Kahn, scholar and multidisciplinary performer Jen Soriano, and Washington State Poet Laureate Rena Priest. So everyone, let's cozy on up, grab a beverage, maybe even an adult beverage, some snacks. And just to kind of set the scene, I wanted to read this quote from Maya Angelou. To describe my mother would be to write about a hurricane in its perfect power or the climbing, falling colors of a rainbow. Okay, so our first reader, Arlene Naganawa, is currently a writer in the schools with Seattle Arts and Lectures and a volunteer poetry mentor with Pongo Teen Writing. Her chapbooks include Private Graveyard, The Scarecrow Bride, and The Ark and the Bear. Her work appears in La Picheletta Barca, Waxwing, Crab Creek Review, Bellatrist, and other publications. In 2019 and 2020, she received a grant for artist projects from Artist Trust and a City Artist Grant from the Seattle's Office of Arts and Culture. She's excited to be included in Telephone, an international interactive art project that explores how aesthetic and motif travel can transform in an interconnected age. Everyone, please welcome Arlene Nakanawa.
Hi, everybody. Thank you so much. It's an honor to be here and part of this series. I also echo the land acknowledgement. This series is about growing up, and I will be reading a few poems about others growing up, my own childhood, and about my mother. The first three poems I'm reading are responses to youth I wrote with in King County Youth Detention and Echo Glen Children's Center. It's always a privilege to work with youth, and a particular privilege when the young men and women share their experiences, both joyful and heartbreaking. Sometimes growing up is very difficult and made more difficult by incarceration. The first poem is a response to an installation by Tavares Strawn at the Fry Museum that featured neon signs and the seated Pachin Lama, a Pyrex sculpture of the cardiovascular system of the Pachin Lama, scaled to the size of an adolescent. This human scale sculpture was immersed in a 40-inch high glass tank of mineral oil lit from below. It is a response to the disappearance of a 6-year-old boy who disappeared into Chinese custody after the Dalai Lama recognized him as the true reincarnation of the Pachin Lama. In the same way, incarcerated youth often disappear from society. Some of the neon signs featured the words sometimes and always. Always, sometimes, never. After lights out, neon letters, sometimes arrows sprayed, walls tagged in dreams. We belong here, like the arteries of the 6-year-old llama trapped somewhere unseen, his ether body invisible. Always the young men sidestepping pools of shadow under jail slippers, neon sweatshirts, hands behind your back, in the air. Our mothers, like feathers in down jackets stolen from the back seat of the car. Always ice encased, visible from one angle, one circulatory justice, seen, unseen. Spirits like spray paint. I am here. Sometimes spirits like feathers side sweep the street. 6 years old, I don't love myself. There was no food, not always. If we go to Echo, there are deer walking through the cave where I would be if I had an inside self. To tell the truth, I don't understand. I love my mom with all my heart. Thank you, miss. If you need to get a hold of me, I'll be here. I'll be here. My second poem is dedicated to a young man who showed me his new tattoos. And this is called Mi Vida Loca. And those are three dots that are a common prison tattoo. Mi Vida Loca. He shows her his new tattoos, three dots under his left eye. And in the crease of his elbow, silky skin pierced, filled. And on his inner wrist, a scar like a mouth, the blood like spilled ink, the spilt milk, palm held to the searing cast iron pan, greased with bacon, eggs with fluttery edges thrown to the door. Three dots like sharp pops from the intersection, like buttons to press her fingers to, like tears, like little kisses. And my third poem about writing with the youth is dedicated to the volunteers that I worked with and to the youth. Where are the animals? In the cell blocks, lights flicker like mosquitoes. We move slowly, speak in low voices, hand out pencils too short to puncture an artery, sheets of ruled paper. We explain ways to write poems, how every person has a day or a song or something warm once held close in the dark, how their dogs wait on the porch, teeth like the sun, how shadows, hands like smoke, hover the haunches, pass through the heat, torn apart in their dreams. This next poem is written to a muse because muses or role models are so important in growing up. This poem contains several lines from Toni Morrison and a nod to Arcelys Germay for the Queen of Kindness. I made a wreath of leaves, each leaf a light, burgundy and lime, dry and tender, a breathing forest floor, a flicker knocking, a funnel web I didn't recognize, sunlight drove into the rocks, rose, but with a yellow in it. We rode into each other's lines like sisters, our poems of other worlds. Lily wilting like wet silk, candles listless and unbearable. You protected yourself and love small. I sealed a nickel in a walnut shell. I made a lemon into a pig, cloves for luck, penny cut into its silent jaw. The stone, the flower, the snail, softly. I'm going to read two poems about my own childhood, which was happy, but as we grow up, we experience loss. This is called Diane. She was my friend when I was 4 and she's since passed. My childhood friend, her hair slicked back with a headband, white plastic stamped with rosebuds, is standing barefoot under the sprinkler. No one will give her a map of her young heart or her woman's cells. Oh, dish towels and panties stretched on the line, shiver of delphinium. Oh, wading pool, fox terrier, glass of leftover milk. One afternoon, we left our bikes, both of us, for the secret place, forest on a cliff, dim and fresh, with paths in a cave of fallen branches. There we were we, a beginning like an underground stream bubbling to surface, too clear for tadpoles, though we wanted it to be something becoming, whole robin egg, shed snakeskin, mouse skull, perfect and clean. In this next poem, if you've lived in Seattle for a long time, you might know of a catastrophic warehouse fire in the International District. In that fire, 4 firefighters died, and one was my good friend, Greg, from high school. This poem is about being a teenager and later a mother. If you're familiar with the play Our Town, which I did read in high school, you know that Emily dies as a young wife, and her husband, George, visits her grave. In the play, the dead can see the people they love living their lives on earth. Emily wants to go back just for one day. In senior English, the best part of Our Town was after Emily died. She was sitting in her wooden chair with the other dead people, wishing she could have one day to drink coffee, see her mother, wear an iron dress. What struck me as I sat at my desk, looking out the window at the phone line stretched across the rain, was that dead people still wanted. Riding the metro to my after-school job, I looked at the buttons of old gum stuck to the rubber mats and smelled fish the women carried home in their shopping bags and thought about how many things we miss and long for. Snow falling on our hair, and loose papers blown against a curb, even while they're happening. Then it was spring and baseball, the last time I'd cheer in the bleachers and watch Greg Shoemaker slide into third, the last time I'd write for the school paper, the only time I'd see our town on stage. Half in love with our handsome teacher, half with Greg, I longed for George, overcome with love, to fling himself on Emily's grave. 25 years later, I think about Emily up on stage, but it's my daughter now, 15, looking in the mirror, wanting to know, "Mother, am I pretty?" I think about her and her wooden chair, and I and mine, and Greg and all the others sitting together, hands folded in our laps, missing everything. And my last poem's for my mom. The world knows you by heart. At 6 o'clock, the sun's already flung itself inside your room, your youngest child, toy duck in hand, yellow sleeper, gold duck feet, dandelion shimmer in the parking strip. It's almost real this morning. The butter on French toast, Folgers in the percolator, aqua parabolas on the formica, crocheted dishcloth you wring out in the sink. Faithful robins pull faithful earthworms as remembered. The clock clicks, the chime inside tick-ticking like a heart. At 8 o'clock, the children off to school, wax paper sandwiches, bologna and mayonnaise, red apples. The children like their milk. White lilacs from the neighbor's yard spill like froth. Your hands feel lacy in this dream, if one dreams in death. The garden filled with gladiolas, red and yellow blooms like trumpets, like bells from another world, a room of line-dried sheets and iron pillow slips. Thank you.
Everyone, let's give Arlene Naganawa a wonderful round of applause. Thank you so much, Arlene, for those tender and heartfelt poems. And I wanted to say thank you for your dedication and support for young people with your work at WITS and Pongo Teen Writing. And it's clear that your commitment to young people influences your work. And I'm actually wondering, what have young people taught you as you're kind of supporting them and encouraging them? What have they taught you?
Well, I'd have to say, without irony, everything. I was a public school teacher and independent school teacher for 40 years too. So I've been around kids all my adult life. And I just have to say you really learn a lot as an adult from children. And I have my own children as well. One thing I did want to say that I noticed in when I first began to work with incarcerated youth, I would say almost everyone would say that they love their mothers. And that was a thread that ran through year after year, that they really love their mothers.
Gotta get those tissues. thank you so much. And special shout out to school teachers, by the way. Thank you for all the work that you do. And again, everyone, let's give Arlene a round of applause. I appreciate you being here.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, DA. Thank you, library.
Awesome. Okay, great. All right, we're off to a wonderful start, and we're moving on to our next reader, and that's going to be Margot Kahn. Margot Kahn is a poet, essayist, biographer, and editor. She is the author of Horses That Buck from University of Oklahoma Press and co-editor of the New York Times Editor's Choice Anthology, This Is the Place. Her poems have appeared or are forthcoming in Grist, Nimrod, Whiskey Island, Portland Review, Crab Creek Review, Poetry Northwest, New England Review, New Ohio Review, and elsewhere. Everyone, please welcome Margot Kahn.
Thank you so much, DA and Stesha and Seattle Public Library and Rena and Jen and Arlene. It's an honor to read with you all. I love the subject of this evening. I always love hearing from other mothers about motherhood in particular, but childhood. It was fun to think about these poems together. I'm going to read some poems tonight that are about childhood from the perspective of both the child or the grown-up child and from the perspective of the parent, which, as DA, you said in your introduction, is fun and interesting. Of course, you know, there's a whole different take on childhood. once you grow up and when you become a parent or an aunt or an uncle or a godparent, the world kind of cracks open yet again. So I'm going to start with a poem that's looking back at my own childhood, my high school years. This also happens to be one of the very first poems I wrote when I started writing a few years ago. Generations. In class, we had partners, and the partners had tubes of anesthetized fruit flies sorted by eyes. Our task was to feed them and gas them and count them, to sort and combine red eyes with white. 3 days passed, then 7, then 9, and we never returned, my partner and I. The idea was hers, but it might have been mine. Into the hall of lockers lined, we took our tube, multiplied, and with one move, we set them free and kissed our biology grade goodbye. So my son Toby is 10 years old now, and I started writing poetry when he was 7 because prior to that I had really considered myself a biographer, and although I had a new subject for a biography, I just felt like I had no time to travel and research in the way that that was going to require. So I started writing poems, and in those days it was really difficult to get to school. Now it's actually pretty easy, but in those days it was so hard that I wrote several poems about it. And this first one is a sonnet that was originally called "Please, for the Love of God, Put on Your Shoes," but now it's called "How We Say Goodbye." How We Say Goodbye. When we arrive, the classroom lights will be low, tender boots tipped under coat hooks, rushed, chaotic, overfull. And me, I'll be too wet to hug, library books tucked under your arm anyway. But looks don't yet scare you off a kiss, so I'll take that. My heart, a box of lures and fish hooks, dry flies so intricately tied, I ache to use them. The same way I want to make you stay and go both, while voices rise and riffle from this riparian landscape of youth, along which I hold your small hand, watch you wade, sink, and rise, and offer prayer for you, sweet boy, if we ever get there. This next is basically the same poem, but on a slightly more disgruntled day. Mixed feelings about my contribution to humanity. There are days in the fall when, on the paths through the park, slugs everywhere are crossing. I come upon them stretched out to their longest lengths, trailing their cursive tracks, and I stop and I stoop and I finger them up, their soft, wet bodies contracting to my touch, and I set them down on the other side in the new grass or the soft, dead leaves. And then there are other days, days when we've been late to school because none of the pants have been comfortable, because a fraction of toast has been left on the plate but cannot be cleared, days when doors have been slammed or books held open, the one offense I find hard to condemn. And I am tired, tired of asking for socks and shoes 7 times, tired of wondering over the whereabouts of rain boots. These days I get to the park and see the biker skimming down the path, see the dog's damp nose, his slip of indiscriminate tongue, and I don't stop. I look at the slugs and say to one after another, good luck, buddy, good fucking luck. So back in the days when we used to be able to travel, I used to get away a few times a year on my own. And I think anyone who's a mother may relate to that moment of getting in the car or on a plane or on a bus by yourself and suddenly feeling like a totally different version of yourself. So I wrote this next poem on the way home from a quick trip to Portland. And if you've driven that stretch of I-5 between Portland and Seattle, you might recognize the strange missiles in the last lines. On the bus through Oregon. A banner of geese unfurls, cut loose from bolted storm clouds. Stray snags and burnt cartilage erupt out of backyards, loneliness jackknifed toward a too bright light. A freight of peonies goes north, aching open and broken down. In all other directions, brush fire, burn piles. I'm no one's mother here, yarn around my fingers, oranges at my feet. But I am a promise of return, a mother as anecdote to that lawn where 100 missiles are arranged in lines, aimed at nothing, aimed at the sun. So a few years after college, I learned that a guy I had loved, mostly from afar, had died. I'd watched him play cello in the orchestra from my spot in the college choir. And in that bacchanalia that is the end of senior year, we did have a little hookup. And every now and again, there's something that makes me think of him. But unlike when I first learned of his death many, many years ago, and I was sad for him and sad for myself, since becoming a parent, I just think of his mother. This poem is called If Someone Says Catalina. If someone says Catalina, I think of this Janis Joplin long hair, low slung corduroy, California flip-flop cello playing boy. His hair swung like a tiki bar curtain, the fringe of a flapper dress across my legs. Together in a twin bed, I was a window and his hair was a shade, and the tassel from my neck to my navel pulled itself down. That boy played like nothing I could afford, 100-year whiskey on the rocks, the melt of a glacier pooled at my feet. Now someone says Catalina or cello or cancer, and I'm there again, singing over his requiem. Tassel and tongue, shade and shroud. Was it the hair or the hands, the sound or the shape of the sound? I'm saying this so that you help me remember him, so his mother knows that night is accounted for. This next poem is very new, and it's also very dark, and it deals with suicide. So for anyone who might not want to hear this one, you could turn your sound off and I'll give a little wave when I'm done with it. The Cleaner. Years ago, I hired a woman to help me clean, and she would text me during the week when she was able to come, in between her other jobs that were haphazard and unpredictable. Her job that paid real money was for the city. When there was a body, a crime scene, she was the one who cleaned it. And she loved this job, she told me. She loved knowing which way the bullets flew and with what velocity a body shattered. She'd come to my house with Q-tips and cleaning products she'd made by hand and tell me everything while I held my baby. The way blood decorates a wall, how far splintered bone can travel, the way scraps of fat and tissue settle into thick carpet, and what it takes to find them, pluck them out with tweezers. One week it was a man who shot himself in the basement. One week a 17-year-old who hung himself in the garage. Someone found them, and then someone called her, my cleaner, to make it disappear, so that when the mother of that boy came home again, she wouldn't find a drop of him, not a vestige of his smell, not a scrap of bitten fingernail. Which makes me wonder what that mother thought would become of her boy when her boy was young, or how I might feel 7 years from now if my son were to leave this world by his own hand. Today on the toilet, while I pee, I stare at the hair on the floor where my husband gave my son a trim and wonder if I should keep it, this clipping that escaped the broom. Okay, these last four poems were written on the tiny island in the Salish Sea where my family grows most of our fruit and vegetables. And the first two were written during two different summers, actually, during our wildfire times. The first of them touches on a lot of family history, both mine and my husband's, and that of my grandparents, who, although this poem doesn't say it explicitly, fled their home countries in 1938 and 1940. In the very last poem, called Fermata, you'll hear a reference to the way that people on the island wave from their cars when they're driving. And I've seen this in other rural places I've been, but it's definitely not something I experienced growing up in Cleveland, Ohio. Exile. On Saturday, I trolled for places back home. Home as in the place I was raised, not that elusive ancestor thing, the soul, or just the place where my mother set plates of flank steak in front of me, or left me with a cardboard box, the frozen trays. When everything's up in flames, I yearn for a yard I know the edge of, for lightning bugs trapped in a punched lid jar, the lip of the brick fireplace where my father sang his Navy songs, and the kitchen where my mother baked blackberry pie that bled out across the floor. The days I drove myself to school and picked myself up, hotwired the minivan, got felt up, and learned about loneliness from a phone attached to the wall. The place my parents were the first to be born to, the place I had the privilege of being bored, the place I had the privilege of leaving. Here, from my kitchen window, the hills are first to disappear. Then goes the fence, the garden, the rutted gravel drive. My lungs hurt just watching it, reading in sans serif that friends had minutes to flee. I see the hill behind their house awash in light, ablaze, a transcendental image for an Instagram age. She posts it as they're rushing away to the country of the displaced, a land I know the scent of, a language I too can speak. A quiet day with the West on fire. Upstairs, a boy hums while he plays. Inside a mason jar, a caterpillar rests on the branch of a plum tree. Cake sits on the counter. Bread cools. A tomato ripens, even as we hold our breath, waiting for the wind and rain. We've asked ourselves the same question 1,000 times. I watch the caterpillar sleep. I listen to the boy sing. In these days of smoke and haze, I hold on to the smallest things. My fear as suffocating as the open ocean. My heart as boundless as the sky we used to know. Field of vision. Feathery as a frayed hem, in the wind, the hayfield moves like the tufted manes of 1,000 horses running. No, it moves like the pleated skirts of 1,000 girls swishing as they walk to school. After school, there was a girl's field we'd crouch down in, curl and shiver like fawns as someone's legs passed by so close it seemed impossible they'd miss you. They were tortures in equal measure, the waiting and the being found. From the edges of that field, the girl's father whistled. There was a whistling tune and another sound that brought the children running sharp as sheepdogs from the hayfield or the fronds of the willow tree or the far fence we'd half climb to watch the horses in the neighbor's field pretending they were ours. Last week at the post office, the tellers could barely be heard over the 1,000 chicks cheeping in cardboard boxes behind the counter, their feathery non-feathers, their cheeps of being young in a strange place with only a small hole to see through. I didn't do well in school, but I have come to understand that a bond is only as strong as a breath of air. When I learned that that girl no longer speaks to her father, I thought of her room strung up with 4-H ribbons, their blue and red tails fluttering against a floral wall. And when my son crawls into bed, whimpering a fetal cry, broken by his parents not understanding him for the first time, I am tender. The hay will be cut tomorrow. The raptors will come circling. We'll watch from the shed roof, where we can see the patterns the mower cuts in the field. And this last one for Mata. Do you know what that means? My son said, kicking his legs beneath the piano keys. His arms outstretched don't yet reach the lowest A or the highest C, but at least he's learning. In my grandparents' living room, I tinkered, never taught, while my grandmother lit candles for everyone she'd lost. There, the old people kept the old country to themselves. Here, the old people lift a finger or two off the steering wheel, sometimes a whole hand. When I take a turn, I hesitate, questioning whether the wave or the road is more important. When I was my son's age, my grandmother put a knife through her palm, trying to separate a pair of frozen steaks. She called for help calmly, as if announcing a five-spade hand. Earlier today, when a splinter lodged under my son's nail, I pretended not to know the hurt of severing, the split of skin, or the song of cleaving, so that he might bravely tell me. Thank you.
Everyone, let's give a round of applause to Margot Khan. Thank you so much for that. And Margot, what a roller coaster of such a variety of poems, and it's a testament to just the ups and downs of just what it means to be a human being. I have a question for you, Margot, and the line, good luck, buddy, good fucking luck, just stuck in my brain. And why it did is I was on a walk earlier today, just through the neighborhood and stretching my legs, and there were toddlers, like a daycare, and they're all holding their that little line that like just, and they had two staff members. It was the cutest thing ever. And they were crossing the crosswalk, and I just smile. And the cutest thing happened is the little toddler stuck out their hand towards the traffic. It was like the supreme stop in the name of love. It was adorable. And there's just their little feet, little buddies were trucking along. But why I'm bringing that up is every moment I am with like toddlers or babies, I think of like in my brain, I'm saying, good luck. You got a long road ahead of you. It's going to be pretty wild. So Margot, I want you to imagine this audience as little toddlers. We're crossing the crosswalk. You say, good luck, buddy. And what else advice can you offer us?
Oh my gosh. I love that image so much. And I so relate that it, yeah, that rope line, that they get, it's sweet from afar, but man, I'm always so glad that it's not me. I'm not one of the adults on either end of that thing. Because there's so much trust there, right? Like one of them, they could just let go. Somehow they never do. Anyway, what advice would I give? This is such a hard question. I mean, I've worked with a lot of young people, mostly middle school and high school age people. And, you know, the advice that I'm giving now, which maybe doesn't totally apply to toddlers, but the advice that I wish I had been given, that I've been giving most, is to find a mentor, find somebody who, I mean, I feel like this applies to adults too. I'm sort of looking towards, you know, someone who's doing the thing that I feel like, oh yeah, that's what I want to be doing. And get in touch with that person and talk to them and just let them kind of give you some wisdom. And you know, if there's something that you see that you know that you want to do, you know, ask for help, ask for guidance to figure out how to get yourself there.
Indeed, definitely agree. And I need mentors, help me. I need some life coaching. But again, thank you so much, Margot, for sharing your work and for that wisdom. So everyone, let's give another round of applause to Margot. Thank you so much. All right, we're continuing on. And next we have Jen Soriano. So Jen Soriano, she, they, is a writer, performer, social movement strategist, and parent to a seven-year-old who is also one of her best friends. In 2019, they published a chapbook of lyric essays and prose poems called Making the Tongue Dry, now in its second edition, from Arts by the People. Making the Tongue Dry was a finalist in the Newfound, Cutbank, and Gazing Grain chapbook contest. Melissa Phoebos has called Jen's work powerful and luminous and chose her essay Unbroken Water as winner of the 2019 Penelope C. Niven Prize for the Center for Women's Writers. Aisha Sabatini Sloan chose her essay Warfire as the winner of the 2019 Fugue Prose Prize, calling her work vivid and cinematic. Jen has received fellowships from the Vermont Studio Center, Hugo House, and the Jack Jones Literary Arts Retreat. They are currently hard at work on a memoir and essays about historical trauma and the neuroscience of healing. Everyone, please welcome Jen.
Thank you so much. I've really enjoyed hearing everything that Arlene and Margot had to share, and I can't wait to hear Rena's poetry. I just feel like the landscape of themes around growing up and parenting and caregiving, that's already been covered. It's just been really phenomenal. And I just feel like, yes, such an honor to be part of this. And thank you to everybody who is in the Zoom room, whom we can't see. Thank you for being here. You know, it's kind of, you know, eating time maybe. So hopefully y'all are behind the screen nourishing yourselves with food as well as poetry and prose, which I'm about to read. So I'm going to share, an essay that seems like it's never done. I'm always continuously working on it. And I just keep adding to it and changing it a little bit every so often over the course of the past, at least 5 years. So it is, has found its latest iteration inspired by this theme. I will just go ahead and share it with you. It's called Marginalia. You might think it's sacrilege, but I've been teaching my seven-year-old to write inside his books. He holds a number two pencil, incorrectly, so his teachers say, and applies the tip to whatever empty space he can find around the printed words. Writing to him can be a chore. When he picks up a writing instrument, he sometimes groans and squirms and braces as if using every muscle in his body to hold its weight. And only then does he begin to write, grunting like I used to do when hauling trash out to the curb. But my son is a great writer and he loves to read. And he has opinions and he likes to share them. So I like to encourage him to scribe these opinions as he reads. What does he think that bunny who wants to be a cop should do? What's the moral of the story about the alligators who flush themselves down toilets to travel through sewers to solve crimes? Or about James and the giant peach and the giant insects and saddled seagulls and squashed aunties? And does he agree? If not, what would he write instead? My son answers my questions verbally with gusto, then reluctantly scrawls some thoughts down on the page. I'm trying to teach my son the beauty of marginalia and the power of what lies to the side of the story that's placed at the center. In the early 80s, when I was about seven, I religiously watched a TV show called The Courtship of Eddie's Father. In the show, little Eddie was a matchmaker. He was like Tinder before the internet. He spent most of his time setting up his widower dad with women who could become his new mom. And meanwhile, their housekeeper quietly kept their house and their lives in order. This housekeeper was a Japanese woman named, for some reason, Mrs. Livingston. In the early 80s, Mrs. Livingston was the only person who looked anything like me in the big world of magazines and TV screens. I would sit through 22 minutes of the show and 8 minutes of commercials waiting for Mrs. Livingston to appear. When she did, she would move about the home in a shapeless maid frock, tucking Eddie in and kissing him goodnight, or serving coffee to Eddie's father while telling him all about his son's exploits. I would smile in satisfaction as flashes of her appeared on screen, and I imagined her floating back and forth from Hollywood directly into my living room. I thought of her as an auntie I never had. The courtship of Eddie's father had a tagline that went, "A boy and his dad have a barrel of fun." I don't remember what they did to have fun, much less a barrel of it, but I do remember Mrs. Livingston and how her presence was at once fleeting and constant. I knew that even when she was off screen, she was still there in Eddie's house, perhaps folding laundry or making beds off to the side. While Eddie and his dad had a barrel of fun, Mrs. Livingston, I presumed, was not having fun. On screen, she looked kind of serious. So why wasn't she part of the fun? On the cover of TV Guide, Eddie sat on top of his dad's shoulders in the front of the picture laughing. And in the background was Mrs. Livingston looking up at Eddie, hands clasped and smiling, but at a distance. Why did she not get to stand beside Eddie and his father laughing along? As an adult, I grew to understand that Mrs. Livingston was never meant to be at the center of the story. She was an Asian equivalent of what Spike Lee calls the magical Negro, a Black character who gets no backstory and whose sole purpose is to mystically and sacrificially support the white protagonists in getting what they want. She was also the Asian equivalent of Sancho Panza, the working class sidekick who loyally supports the chaotic quest of their master, in this case, Eddie's quest to find a new wife for his father. But as a seven-year-old, I knew nothing about these concepts, and Spike Lee had not yet coined the term. Blissfully ignorant of this analysis, my seven-year-old mind, programmed at the time for heteronormativity, constructed a different story. To me, Eddie and Mrs. Livingston looked a little bit alike. Eddie's eyes were slanted, even more than mine, even more than Mrs. Livingston's. Mrs. Livingston lived under the same roof as Eddie and his father, and she was cute and actually way cuter than Eddie's father, and the two seemed not so far in age, so I was proud of myself for having figured out a secret. Mrs. Livingston and Eddie's father were actually married, and Eddie was Mrs. Livingston's son. Mrs. Livingston was Eddie's mom. They just couldn't tell anyone the truth because, well, Mrs. Livingston was their maid, and she was an Asian woman, and well, there's a place for people like that. I would learn this lesson again and again growing up in the American Midwest. There's a place for people like that, for people like us, Asian Americans and specifically Asian women and girls. When I was in third grade, our school put on a play called The Wizard of Oz in the Wild Wild West. I told my teacher I wanted to be Dorothy. She bent down and held my face between her hands and said, "Oh, sweetie, of course you do." Then she handed me a calico bonnet and a script titled Townsperson Number 2. Townsperson Number 1 was my friend Namrata Shah. The parts of Dorothy, the Tin Man, the Cowardly Lion, the Scarecrow, and Annie Oakley all went to white classmates. In eighth grade, we did a play that was a twist on Huck Finn. I was cast in a role where my love interest was the only Asian boy in my class. He was the town butcher, and I, of course, was a maid. I don't think my son is growing up with quite the same experiences of marginalization. As a cisgendered and light-skinned brown boy in a liberal town, he now gets to see kids who look like him at the center of school curriculum and as the star of kids' shows like Paw Patrol and Super Why. But at the same time, below his phenotype runs the blood of two marginalized cultures. He is Filipinx and Puerto Rican, a mixture of ancestral history forged by colonization and resistance. Like me, my son is very sensitive. He at once seeks recognition and is slightly afraid of being seen. This, I think, is perhaps an adaptation from ancestors who learned to hide to survive. but who knew that this was not the only way to live? Here is a story from the margins that we are teaching him. Like a handful of other peoples who have had the misfortune of being discovered, Filipinos have been massacred, civilized, and invisibilized for hundreds of years. Puerto Ricans have been massacred, civilized, and invisibilized for hundreds of years. My son comes from both these lineages, and there is something to be learned from the guerrilla art of hiding and the power of persisting in the margins. After all, there was a word for those who put themselves at the center of a colonial regime. Collaborators. Resistors, by definition, stayed on the sidelines. According to early 80s America, the place for Asian Americans was most definitely on the sidelines, but I would argue from my vantage point, also in the foundation. In the courtship of Eddie's father, Mrs. Livingston flitted in and out of each scene, and yet she was a cornerstone of Eddie's household. This was just an entertainment industry reflection of how Asian Americans, and indeed most minorities, have been treated in this country as a whole. Japanese Americans fought for the Allied forces in World War II while their families were imprisoned in internment camps. Filipino Americans cut sugarcane and harvested tomatoes and grapes while being essentially outlawed from having their own families. Chinese laborers literally built the infrastructure that allowed for white settler expansion across America and were then excluded from entry into the new United States. Asian Americans are both central to the history of America and complicit in it. We are both a cornerstone of American culture and forbidden from it. Like the foundation of a house, Asian Americans are often relegated to the underground, to places where you have to dig to find our full humanity. While writing this, I did some digging to learn about the woman behind Mrs. Livingston, the actor behind the housekeeper. Miyoshi Umeki had realized many different roles in her life. Before appearing as Mrs. Livingston on the courtship of Eddie's father, Umeki was a successful singer in both the United States and Japan. She recorded dozens of jazz singles with RCA Victor and Mercury Records, as well as a full album titled Miyoshi. When she moved to America, she began to act as well, landing the lead role in the 1958 Broadway production of The Flower Drum Song. For this role, she was nominated for both a Golden Globe and a Tony. And in 1957, Umeki won an Academy Award for Best Supporting Actress for her role opposite Marlon Brando in the movie Sayonara. She is still the only Asian woman actor to have ever won an Oscar. It was only after accruing these accomplishments that Miyoshi Umeki became Mrs. Livingston, the no-nonsense helper and wingwoman to Eddie and his father. Her story is emblematic of what people of color, and especially immigrants of color, must sacrifice in order to carve out space beside dominant culture. Her story is also emblematic of the power that can be wielded from this place. My son is growing up in a different time, or is he? These days, Asian Americans have more representation in entertainment, literature, and politics than we did in the 1980s. But how much more? Is it proportional to how many of us there are? And during a rising tide of anti-Asian violence, how much does this representation even matter? My son is proud of being born and raised in Seattle. He is well represented at his school, which is majority Asian and Latinx, and he feels squarely at home here with the gray and the cold and the mountains and lakes and the rain. As a mixed race child, he is in a growing minority majority here, but as a mixed race child of two people of color, he remains still in the margins. Because he is light skinned, I worry about him identifying with the white liberal culture that's so dominant here in Seattle. He does not have as strong of a Puerto Rican community as he would have if we had stayed on the island, nor as strong of a Filipino community as if we had stayed in the Bay. So we tried to create cultural anchors through our own family practices, through trips to the homeland, through music and books. Instead of gravitating toward a center of whiteness, we want him to find joy and strength in the margins of being a mixed race Filipino or Boricuapino little person. Part of this is ensuring he has books to read about Roberto Clemente and Larry Itliong and the struggle in Vieques and the fight to save the I Hotel. And part of this is encouraging his scrawls in the white space between the giant peach and the edge of the page. My son is growing up and his story is still being written, and I wonder how he will remember. How will he remember the pandemic? I wonder how he and his generation will evolve our thinking about race and gender and how they will face climate change, and if I will be able to help along the way. Though right now I'm central to my son's daily life and his imagination, I believe I'm only a marginal character, and with that, I'm content. Not because I want to be the Mrs. Livingston to his life experience, but because I want to raise him to think of what lies in the margins as equal in importance, if not more important than what lies at the center. I want to raise him to always question dominance, to upset the traditional order of things, and to find solutions at the fringes of the mainstream. Speaking of fringe, I'll close with this. Right now, my son is obsessed with dodo birds. In fact, he is on a mission to upend the conventional notion that dodo birds were dumb. Instead, he wants the world to know that they may have been sweet and happy for millions of years before humans came along and caused their extinction, and that they were so smart they knew how to eat rocks to help them digest berries and not have upset tummies. This is his version of revising a story from the margins. Whether he knows it or not, in his obsession, he is lifting up values of remembering and recovery from loss, environmental adaptation and interdependence, and he is holding a vision of a world where beings can live in balance and therefore endure. I encourage my son to write at the edge of the page, and though I can't read all of what he scrawls, it's for him to know and for the rest of us to find out. I think of all the worlds he might rewrite together with others in his generation, and I can only hope to be around to witness from the sidelines. Thank you.
Everyone, please give a round of applause to Jen Soriano. What an incredibly multi-layered work, and it tells me about the complexities of worldly and sometimes ugly facts that we have to live with, and those facts that will be in conflict with children growing up. And then there's the adults who are caught in the middle of all this. So I am very curious. You had mentioned before you were reading that you had tweaked or changed this work based on the theme of growing up. So I just curious to know more about that. Like, how did this theme of growing up change this piece of work?
Well, I mean, the theme is what first led me back to the work, because it was, you know, it's an essay that I wrote about, you know, a moment in my growing up that really sticks out to me. You know, it's like some people might think of like a milestone that has to do with, you know, I don't know, the time with their grandmother or something. Me, it was like me watching this TV show. So I went back to that, and then I just started to, basically all the parts about my son are tweaked, are new. I started just think about, you know, what would I want to tell him about why was I so obsessed about this with this TV show? And so then that's where all the threads that are about him started to make their way into the piece.
Gotcha. I mean, what a wonderful element to add your child into this, because it just pushed the narrative even further. And it just makes me think about if there's works that's like passed down from generation to generation where it just like gets extended even further. But yeah, what a wonderful, I'm just like, it's sinking in my brain. So I need to, one of those moments to like think about life and my direction and all that goodness. But thank you so much for sharing your work. Everyone, again, a round of applause to Jen Soriano. Thank you so much for being here.
Thanks so much.
Awesome. Okay, folks, thanks for being with us again. And we're moving on to our fourth and final reader, and that will be Rena Priest. Rena Priest is a poet and an enrolled member of the Lummi Nation. She has been appointed to serve as Washington State Poet Laureate for the term of April 21 through 2023. Heck yeah. She is the recipient of the Vadon Foundation Fellowship and an Allied Arts Foundation Professional Poets Award. Her debut collection, Patriarchy Blues, was published by Moon Path Press and received an American Book Award. Her second collection, Sublime Subliminal, is available from Floating Bridge Press. She holds an MFA from Sarah Lawrence College. Learn more at renapriest.com. Everyone, please welcome our poet laureate, Rena Priest.
Hi, everyone. I'm so happy to be here with you this evening. I Squile, Sahualtanat, Sinasnat, Shachlamisan, Ohelixan, Quenrisan, Attach, Alitia Caius. I'd like to begin by thanking Humanities Washington and the Washington State Arts Commission for their support, for their joint support of the Poet Washington State Poet Laureate Program. And of course, all the other readers who've read with me this evening, and DA and Stesha and the Seattle Public Library for hosting this event. Thank you so much. So I'll begin with a poem. When I was a child, I remember always going to the nail salon with my mom, and I never ever did get my first manicure until I went to graduate school in New York City, and nail salons were everywhere, and I thought, oh, I'm gonna try this, right? But I remember when I had my daughter, she used to take my daughter to get her little teeny tiny nails done, and she'd come back and she'd have red nails. So this is called Nail Salon, and this is from my first book, Patriarchy Blues, and all the rest of the poems that I'll read tonight are uncollected, so they're pretty new. Nail Salon. The colors shimmer in rows along the walls like springtime on shrooms, a conundrum conjuring variety glistening like an impossible city. Choice is always a factor in happiness. The more choices we're given, the greater our capacity for dissatisfaction. It's okay, there's always red. But then there they stand, a selection sorted aside, sorted in their suggestion. Snake's tongue, Granny used to call painted nails. Poesis, I say, the name to make the shade. Fishnet stockings red, Freaky Friday nights red, Gypsy girl red, vodka and caviar red, drive church ladies insane with envy red, cat bite red, will somebody please pay attention to me red. All this, and still I can't find a shade to fit the statement that I want to make. This predatory capitalist patriarchy is killing me, and I'm trying to learn to like it. Why have I never seen that shade in here before? Probably the labels are too small, so they go on and call it Mama Sing the Blues and forget it. So I never did really get used to getting my nails done. I always thought it was kind of a strange, weird thing. So that poem might suggest a little bit about that. This next poem could also share a title with one of Margot's poems, Please, for the Love of God, Put on Your Shoes. It makes reference to my daughter and I being perpetually late. When she was in the seventh grade, she was late to school like 60 times, and I was certain they were gonna come and take her from me, but that didn't happen, thank God. So this poem is called Elevator. We're late, waiting for the elevator. I grumble at daughter. Don't worry about me. Keep focused on getting ready yourself. The doors open and the neighbors hear my scold. To dispel the awkward moment, the guy neighbor holds up a cake. I have cake, he says. If we get stuck in here, we won't go hungry. We won't have to eat each other, I say. Well, not right away, he responds. I smile. The gal neighbor looks uncomfortable, looking around at her fellow passengers. I think she knows she'd be the first to go. What's the cake for, I ask. We're going to a Passover dinner. In the car, daughter says, wow, Mom, that got dark quick. Our poor neighbors were on their way to a nice dinner and have now been confronted with the fact that their neighbor would cannibalize them in an elevator. Not right away, I said. He had Passover cake. Besides, I'm sure they know about Catholics, how we've been eating Jesus Christ for the last 2,000 years. That's my blasphemy poem. So this next one also features her voice, and it's called The Frolicsome Crests and Glistening, with an epigraph by Walt Whitman, What Is It Then Between Us? There are 20 million pounds of gold suspended in normal seawater, spread out in parts per trillion. Gold is a good conductor of electricity, but seeing how it's sought, I'll bet it's the best conductor of a heart's deepest want. I once had a conversation with my daughter in which she asked, Do you believe everything is connected? That depends, I said. On what, she asked. On whether you're being spiritual or conspiratorial. Spiritual, she said. Then yes, I said, everything is connected. How can everything be connected spiritually but not conspiratorially, she asked. Considering it, I believe the spirit conspires against our errant belief that we are separate. I might be you, you might be me, we might be the living sea with 20 million pounds of gold shimmering suspended between us, conducting our heart's deepest wants across frolicsome crests and glistening, and what else could it be if not a spiritual conspiracy? So that one talks about interconnection in a very positive and happy way. And I'm sorry, but I have to get dark on you now. This one is looking at our interconnection with nature and the world that we live in, and also how the southern resident killer whales are struggling. And there's this belief that what happens to them happens to us, this Clackamish belief that their world is a reflection of ours, it's a mirror. And this poem is called Words of Encouragement, and it references Talaqua and her 17-day tour of grief, the mother killer whale. And then also it talks about Tokatai or Skalichaktanat or Lolita, the whale that was captured here in 1970 and is still being held at Miami Seaquarium. And Lemmy, my tribe has been engaged in efforts to try to repatriate her. So this is called Words of Encouragement, with an epigraph by W.S. Merwin. One must always pretend something among the dying. And that's from his poem On a Coming Extinction. When writing poems about extinction, it's important that you make the poems deep, but uplifting. Nobody wants to read a bummer poem about endangered orcas and their dead babies. Keep it light. Keep it motivational, encouraging. It's important to accommodate your gentle reader. Don't say anything about how if you won't swim in it, why should they have to live in it? Don't say that. Honesty is offensive in this day and age. It's always been offensive. How else do you suppose we got here? Maybe instead of saying something like the orcas and salmon are going extinct because of ordinary greed and apathy, instead say something like the noble creature with his power and grace shall journey away forever through the portals of time. Good taste omits mention of baby orcas abducted to be theme park clowns, decades in chlorinated cages taking their eyes, how during the capture so many died. Don't forget to forget what you know about human cruelty, how the baby orcas that didn't survive had their bellies slit and filled with stones and then were sewn closed and dumped into the sea to sink into a silence so dark and so deep public outrage couldn't reach, a depth unfathomable as a mother's grief, too heavy to carry for one day, much less 17. Among the dying, shall we pretend that in the end, we too shall not be listed among the dead? Yes, let's pretend when writing poems about extinction. And that's just kind of also maybe talking a little bit about how when engaging in activism, you have to kind of approach things with a gentle touch in order to have people listen. But then that's so infused with frustration, you know, that you want to just be honest and you want to say it, tell it like it is. So that's kind of hard. But in poetry, the rules aren't the same as in regular activism. I think we can say what we need to say and speak from the heart more authentically, right? So this one is related somewhat to that. It was this is a pantoum that was written in response to Jordan Amani Keith's call for poems relating the struggles of women in urban environments to the struggles of the southern resident killer whales. And she had a program on the 22nd of April featuring these poems and also youth poets who contributed. And so this poem is called Silence from the Deep. And it also talks about the crisis of missing and murdered Indigenous women, which yesterday, May 5th, is a day of acknowledgement for the missing and murdered Indigenous women crisis. So this poem is called Silence from the Deep. How do we mistake desolation for peace? These daughters stolen, these daughters starved. Waves say hush along the beach. Under the waves, there is no reprieve. These daughters stolen, these daughters starved. The major line dwindles as girls go missing. Under the waves, there is no reprieve. From human noise, pollution, hunger, the major line dwindles as girls go missing. The world is a mirror of our hearts. Look away from human noise, pollution, hunger. Everything is endangered or going extinct. The world is a mirror of our hearts. Look away so as not to see how under the waves, everything is endangered or going extinct. When orcas no longer sing, will we see? Will we see how under the waves that say hush along the beach? When orcas no longer sing, will we see how we mistook desolation for peace? So there's a project at Cambridge University, and it's it looks at it's called anthropogenic, and it looks at the greatest threats to the human species, and they're identified as artificial intelligence, global warming, nuclear war, and rogue biotechnology. And I think that as a mother, I think all the time about what my daughter and what her life is gonna be and what she will endure. And it informs my actions a lot. And I think that for any mother, it's how we build our lives around, you know, something good for our children. And this next poem talks a little bit about, it's based on two memories. My own memory of my mother coming home from the cannery covered in fish scales when I was a child. And one of my uncle's stories about my grandmother coming home the same way. And he said she looked so tired. And he said, "You must have cleaned a lot of fish today." And she said, "I think we cleaned out all of Puget Sound." And that sort of haunts me a little bit, knowing that generations of women all the way back into the 1800s worked in canneries processing our sacred food for distribution outside of our community, and relied on commodity foods from the United States government to feed families because we were prohibited from practicing our inherent right to harvest from nature. But this poem is called Remembering Tata at Tamhuiksen. Tata is the affectionate name for mother in Chlamychosin, and Tamhuiksen is the place name near where I grew up, where there was a small cannery. A glossary of bell-related words, chimes, sings, peals, tolls. It is a feeling of silver. It rings and shines at the edges like the scales of a fish. It flickers, tintinnabulates, the signal of a charm, of magic, of a movie memory sequence. And then there is mother, home from the cannery, covered in the scales of hundreds of gutted fish. She shimmers like a mermaid. Long day, I ask. When I lunch at noon, she replies, the sky is a polished silver spoon. By quitting time, tarnish has overtaken all signs of shine. That's how long the day is. You must have cleaned a lot of fish, I say. I think we cleaned out all of Puget Sound. There used to be gooseberries at Gooseberry Point. Now there is the cannery. Won't be long before all the fish are gone. Then the cannery will go, and all we'll have is hunger and sorrow. A burden is the heaviest bell of a carillon. Its register is low. I wish I had a magic wand to chime the cheerful sound of gooseberries sprouting up out of the ground. So this next poem I wrote after reading an essay by Lee Miracle called Remembering Snock, and she talks about the place that belonged to her people. It was like a place of harvesting and gathering. And at the time that I read that essay, I'd also been learning in my Chosin class, where I'm trying to learn Hulnukin, my tribal language, about how most of our place names are associated with the food that was gathered there. So there was a place where we dug camas, and there was a place, Lummi Island was actually called Samamiyuk, because it was where we harvested deer. Samamiyuk is the place where you go to get deer, and so on and so forth. So throughout the islands during the summer months, they would take a board from the longhouse, two boards, and make a raft out of two canoes and put everything they needed, nets and everything, in between the two canoes, and then travel throughout the islands harvesting and then return to the winter homes in the fall. So it was like a garden. This whole region was like a garden. And at the same time that I was learning that, I was taking a class online from as a Sarah Lawrence alum, from the scholar Arnold Krupot. And he talked about how in all of the creation stories of all the tribal people that he, you know, all of the tribal creation stories he's read, they all talk about coming up from the place, coming up out of the ground, and then learning how to interact with the place. And that how in contrast that is to the creation story of the Bible, where you come up out of the ground and then you're expelled. You know, you don't learn how to interact in the place, you get, you know, expelled. So this poem is called Suitu Iish Shatunukin, which means the truly beautiful earth. And it's in homage to Mother Earth. This used to be a garden before the strangers came with strange beliefs. They claimed to be cursed with something called original sin, but blessed with something else called dominion over the whole living earth. They ravaged the garden, insisted that the savage wilds must be conquered and subdued in order to be improved. We are part of the earth, thus their belief that we too must be subdued. I wonder if they knew this used to be a garden. On the seventh day, do they look upon their work and see that it is good? I think we need our old beliefs to guide us back to the garden beyond those gates, guarded by that angel with the fiery sword. This used to be a garden. I don't think the strangers knew how the garden grew, so carefully attuned with the rhythms and tones of the earth's own beautiful song sung for untold millennia before they came along. This used to be a garden. It fed us and loved us, and we loved it. We still do, or at least the memory of it. I've heard it said that half histories are half truths and half truths are lies. Let me tell it to you whole. This used to be a garden. And then just to close on a little bit of a high note, and possibly preempting DA's question about advice to young people, this one is called Rolling Uphill, and it's somewhat written to my daughter, who is now an adult and making her way in the world. And I think sometimes it's that's a hard time in your life, right? You're like figuring a lot out, and there's a lot of worry that can happen about things and how they could go wrong. And so I always tell her, you know, I think if you get out of your head a little bit, you'll be fine. This one's called Rolling Uphill. They say somewhere in Washington there's a road where if you put your car in neutral, you'll defy gravity and roll uphill. The scarcity principle says lack breeds lack, that if you have nothing, you'll be sure to attract nothing. Maybe there are places in the mind where you can park your scarcity thoughts and they'll roll uphill into gratitude and abundance. Just kidding. I didn't mean to suggest that this place was only possible. It definitely exists. Let me draw you a map. First, you go past the noise until you reach the silent dancer in the center. Turn with her at each corner until you are the dancer. When the song reverberates in every cell of your body, you've arrived. Park, put it in neutral, and ascend. Thank you all so much for sticking around and being with us this evening. Haishka.
Thank you so much, Rena. Everyone, please give a round of applause to Rena Priest. One quick thing, I think you should put in your bio that your daughter was late. I think you said 66 times. So just a hint. And I think everyone should have a blasphemy poem. I think it's interesting. But thank you for your sharing your activism with us tonight, because it's important for not only our own knowledge, but for future generations. When we think about growing up, it's not just a centered personal lived experience, but it's a universal experience, a shared experience. And what I learned from your reading is that our environment influences how we grow up, and sometimes if we get to grow up. So I want to know, and it's the question I'm going to ask you and all of our readers tonight, is, what advice do you have or can you offer about growing up? And we'll go with Rena and then work our way backwards to Jen, Margot, and then finish with Arlene.
I would say seek out people who lift you up and celebrate who you are with you as much as possible, even if they're not from your immediate surroundings. When I was a teenager, I used to play chess with old men, and that was like a lot of fun. And don't be afraid to try new things.
Wonderful. Yes, hear. I love that. Wonderful. Thank you, Rena. Jen, what about you? What advice can you offer about growing up?
I guess something similar around always be open to learning, because, I learned that from my son, of just how, if you look at everything with the new eyes, and you really get to continue growing. And that is always a good thing. We don't ever have to stop growing up.
I love that. Yes, please. All right. Thank you, Jen. And Margo, what about you? What advice can you offer about growing up?
Oh gosh, I wish that someone had told me when I was in high school that it was all going to work out, and that, you can be your weird self in a world where everyone's trying to, or it feels like everyone's trying to make you be something else or something particular. Just stick with your weird self and just do that. It'll be okay.
Be weird. I love that. Thank you so much, Margo. And then lastly, Arlene, what advice can you offer?
I think sometimes growing up, kids feel very alone, and to realize that they're not alone, that everybody is feeling poorly. And a great line from Ocean Vuong, even when lonely, we are part of the world. Mm. Mm. Know that you're not alone.
Oh, I love that. Thank you so much, Arlene. And actually, thank you all for our readers. Can we get one more round of applause for all of our amazing readers tonight? So thank you so much for sharing your work. And I also want to give a shout out to Arts Washington and Humanities Washington for this supporting this event. And then if I can just answer this question, and that's with a quote from Lois McCaster Bejold, and that is, growing up, I have discovered over time is rather like housework, never finished. So with all that said, please join us for our next event in the series, where we'll have a special Father's Day event honoring fathers, stepdads, father figures, uncles, and more. We will have novelist Ross McMeekin, union organizer and poet Alex Gallo Brown. We'll have writer and president of the Seattle City of Literature, Juan Carlos Reyes, and then poet and community advocate Aaron Counts. And that date will be Thursday, June 17th, 6:30 p.m. Pacific. So thank you so much, folks. And I'm going to pass it on to Stesha for closing remarks.
Thank you so much, DA. And thank you so much, all of the readers. There's a wonderful note from one of the attendees, from Suzanne. It says, poetry feeds me. This was a splendid meal. Thank you all for a rich and inspiring evening. So I just love that and wanted to share that with you. We're just delighted that you could all be here tonight. If you're interested in reading Jen or Rena's books, they're available through our friends at Open Books. Margot's books are available over with our friends at Elliott Bay Book Company. And Arlene's most recent book is available through Floating Bridge Press, who we also love. So go ahead and check out those links in the chat. And as I mentioned earlier, we're interested in hearing from you, and we will post a link to a program survey in the chat, and we'd appreciate it if you took a minute after the event to fill that out. We'd love to hear what you think. And we are so grateful to everybody who made tonight's program possible. Thank you to our program partners, Open Books, as DA mentioned, Humanities Washington, Arts Washington. Thanks to our sponsors, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, the Seattle Times, and the Seattle Public Library Foundation. And of course, thanks to all of you for joining us tonight. Thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you next time, June 17th. We'll see you there.